Welcome to Frequency Matters, the RF and Microwave Update Series. I'm Pat Hindle, and I'm here with my co-host Gary LaRude. This episode, we thought we would cover our February high frequency components and PCBs issue. And we did a lot of 5G articles in this one, targeting Mobile World Congress, as we'll get extra distribution there. We even have a little bit of a European flair to our cover there. I hope everybody likes it.
Yeah.
So the cover story again is two contributions on new RF antenna front-end architectures, and we got a contribution from Gapwaves on their waveguide technology that can be coupled with GaN amplifiers to produce a high-power phased array for millimeter wave applications. So it's a very novel way that they have a patent on that technology. And we also have a contribution from MACOM. They have a new approach for the sub-6 gigahertz massive MIMO 5G applications for base stations. This is a very highly integrated PCB. It's double-sided, and it promises to greatly reduce the size, weight, and power consumption for massive MIMO. So that'll be interesting to take a look at both of those.
Yeah.
And we hope everybody enjoys reading those.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how those architectures get adopted.
So what else did we have for technical features?
Well, I'll go through those, but I do want to say I love the cover. I think it's my favorite.
I'm glad.
It's my favorite cover, I think, of all the Microwave Journal issues since I've been with the journal. So kudos to you and Janice for putting it together.
Thank you.
So we do have three articles. They're all related to 5G. The first from MIT that talks about over-the-air testing, and of course that's a major challenge with 5G because, as you said, massive MIMO and also the beamforming systems with millimeter wave. We have a second article from Pentek. This is very interesting. The concept is using a software-defined radio platform built around the Xilinx RF system on a chip to do 5G development and streamline the process and accelerate time to market. And then a third article, a perspective, from Ben Thomas at Corvo. An interesting perspective. We've been used to global phones for years now, and his argument is with 5G, we're going to lose that. That given the proliferation of frequency bands and also the fact that each region tends to be a little bit different in terms of the bands they're allocating to 5G, it'll be a while before we see a global 5G phone if we can afford it. So a lot of interesting articles so far.
So turning to the news, according to the analyst firm Canalys, they reported that the smartphone shipments in China are down to the lowest levels since 2013 at just under 400 million shipments. Of course, Huawei and Vivo were two of the top ones at number one and two, right, and they actually increased by 16 and 9% respectively, but some of the lower tiers like Apple were down 13%. So it was a big hit from them, and most of that was due to the Chinese economy being down, but also I think people are hanging on to their smartphones much longer now because they're very expensive, so
right,
you can't afford to buy one every year like you used to be able to do.
Exactly.
And so speaking of Apple, they reported their Q1 earnings, and they were down 5% with respect to the prior year, and down to $84 billion or so.
Amazing.
And they, of course, attributed that to the decline in the Chinese market mostly. Their iPhone shipments were down 15%. But the good news is most of the other sectors were up, so they're doing okay if they can recover from China.
Yeah, they're really trying to kind of migrate from just a hardware platform business to a lot of the services and applications that go around them.
Yeah, you've been doing a great job on your blog and following all these news items. What were a couple other ones that you had?
So last week I caught up with Earl Lum, market analyst, and he and I spent some time on the phone talking about just the state of the industry. I love talking to him because he keeps his finger on the pulse. And so I recorded the conversation and have posted that as sort of a podcast in my blog, so our viewers can watch that or listen to it from the blog. And we talked about several things. Amazed me. He spent the holidays hiking around Sacramento looking at all the Verizon 5G small cell sites. And he's put together a report describing
that. What a vacation.
Yeah, what a vacation. We also talked about the related FCC rulemakings that are trying to streamline 5G small cell siting. And then, of course, we spent a fair amount of time talking about the Huawei drama and the larger picture of national security. So I thought it was a fascinating conversation, always interesting to talk to Earl. So I recommend our viewers listen to that. Then another bit of news, AT&T gave an update on their Project AirGig. This is really interesting because what they're doing is using surface wave propagation of a millimeter wave signal along power lines. And they say they can get very high bandwidths. And so at this point, they've done two field trials. They're looking for a third field trial. And they're also apparently starting discussions with some equipment manufacturers to see about building equipment to actually start deploying. They didn't say exactly when they're going to deploy, but they say that's the goal, that's the objective. And I think this is fascinating, particularly for rural areas, because most rural areas in the U.S. have power, and it may be prohibitive to put a fiber optic line, but you know, if they can leverage this propagation on power lines, they ought to be able to distribute virtually anywhere in the country.
Yeah, it's a unique technology. I'm surprised they've gotten this far, but that's a good sign.
Yeah, so we'll see how that develops. So last week you were at DesignCon.
I was checking out the high-speed digital world for a signal integrity journal, but while I was there, I visited a couple of microwave clients. One is Goosic, and they're producing a high-speed digital board for Keysight. It's an A to D converter with sampling rates up to either 16 or 32 gigasamples per second.
Really?
And an amazing 10 gigahertz of analog bandwidth.
Amazing.
I think most of the top tier test companies are doing 2 gigahertz of real-time bandwidth. This he can do up to 10, so that's amazing. And this board also has either 128 or 256 gigabytes of acquisition memory and does real-time processing with optical data interfaces. So amazing high-speed design that you can see. He showed me the 24-layer board that it goes on. It's incredible.
Wow, the analog microwave world is doomed.
It's merging. And also visited Cobham Guided Munitions Microelectronic Solutions Center in San Jose.
Wow.
And they employ almost 500 people and have 160,000 square feet of space there. And they really are good at the millimeter wave technology for subassemblies. They're on almost every guided munitions or missiles program that's in the U.S., and they make very just form factors for very high-frequency seekers and other applications. And it was very interesting, the general manager there, Alan Takahashi, who we mm-hmm. know from the MACOM days, he was very proud to show us his factory automation and SPC control. They make most of the materials themselves and tightly control the process so they can deliver high performance in various form factors. So,
interesting.
Very interesting place to visit.
Yeah, that's a great facility. Well, I think, as you well know, we're gearing up for Mobile World Congress in a couple of weeks. What, we're getting like 100 invites a day, it seems like.
Quite a bit.
For meetings. I think we've pretty much booked our schedule at this point, thankfully. And looking forward to that, because last year it was all about 5G. With the idea of 5G coming, now 5G is here, so it ought to be a pretty interesting show.
It will be fun.
Yeah. So the other thing we want to tell our viewers about is the EDICON China show is coming up April 1st, 2nd, 3rd. And so registration is open. You can register, get your flights booked. And we just finished the review of the abstracts
yes.
last week. So you can expect the technical program to be released here in the next week or so,
yep,
I would say.
It's pretty much ready.
And then before you know it, we'll be talking about IMS. Coming up this year in Boston. So that's a wrap for our episode today. We want to thank you for watching. And we want to thank MACOM, our consistent sponsor, for making this show possible. The next time you're looking for components from RF to light, check out MACOM's wide portfolio. Until next time.